And here we go. I'm going to get Kayla in here, give her a second to join us. Hallie and Layla, who else is out there? There they are, showing up in force. Zoe. One more. Okay, let's roll. Welcome to episode 5 of this year's live online YAS Summit. We've got an exciting show lined up for you these remaining 3 weeks. And if you missed previous episodes, you can watch them anytime on our YouTube channel. Just go to YAS Summit. This week's special guest is my good friend and neighbor, Kenny Linden.
Yeah, and guys, I want to welcome you all again back to the episode 5 of the YAS Summit. This year's summit, like I said earlier, has the most prizes we have ever offered before. And some of you probably received in your email some of those things saying, here's your prize from our support crew, right? To do and to get those prizes, to get those, all the things that we're offering you guys got to be present. You guys got to participate because it pays to pay attention. Remember to look for clues. Remember to look for hints.
Yes, and for today's prizes, we're offering Amazon gift cards to the first 15 youth who show themselves on screen. Here at the summit, it pays to get on and stay on.
Right now, let's acknowledge all people wearing their favorite hoodies out there.
Yeah, check out some of the hoodies. Kaylin, what's your say on it? You got something on it? Got words on it?
Oh, it just says Harley.
Okay, well, you can't beat that. What else you got? Zoe, what are you wearing?
I'm just wearing a sweater with just
got a couple colors. Yeah. I hope I can make the whole summit episode in this one. It's wool. So it's kind of like a very warm, very nice in the rain and the snow. But boy, it's a bit warm in the old house today. So we'll see how I fare on that one. So great. And it's to you, Zoe.
Hey, Charlie, did we receive any videos from anybody out there since last week?
You know, I didn't. So I see we got Hallie and Layla on there. Are you guys going to send us some cool videos to play here in the future episodes? And you can unmute. There's not that many of us on screen, so this is real manageable.
Maybe.
Okay. How about Hallie?
Well, I was going to do one today, but I'm babysitting, so.
Well, do it. That'd be kind of a cool video, a babysitting video. It kind of gives me an idea. Very cool. So, I'm seeing like you guys out there. Let's see, I'm going to make sure I got everybody on here and not seeing any chats. Last week, I got caught up talking about those conchs. Do you remember those birch things I was talking about? And I got so into it that I forgot to mention their significance and how it relates to chewing tobacco. So for another prize, you guys might know this. Can you tell me how those conchs are used in conjunction with the chewing tobacco? Go ahead, Hallie. And you're muted.
Wait, I'm confused what you're talking about. You're talking about the stuff like that was on the tree?
Yeah, the big conchs, the big.
My dad told me, like, in the bush, they, like, chew it as chewing tobacco. Like, they make their own with it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Did they chew just the ikmik, Hallie? Or do they cut it? So there is a little bit of pure ikmik use I found in my research. Just a little bit of folks, when they run out of everything else, they use pure ikmik. Most of the time, they grind it up, they clean it up, and then they burn it to make an ash. And what they do is they put it into the chewing tobacco because chewing tobacco comes in at about 6.7 pH. It's a little bit acidic, not quite 7, which is water, which is neutral. But they put that in there, it kicks it up a little bit above 7. When you turn chewing tobacco on the basic side, it assimilates into the blood faster. And I forgot to tell you that all last week, or at least I didn't see it when I played the re-recorded show there. So I wanted to mention that to y'all so that you have the information you need to make those decisions. So, okay, so now I have a secret little online game for you. You guys got to guess what I'm doing. And you can just shout out. Any guesses? Who said that?
Abby.
I said Morse code.
Morse code. What did I say? You got it right. Do you know what I said?
I can't read Morse code.
You can't read Morse code. Can anybody take a guess what I said? I said, I just told you all, welcome to the YAS Summit in Morse code. So that's what that was all about. So my wife knows a woman whose full-time job it is on JBear, that's the Air Force base over here, to keep a Morse code program always at the ready. Now, why would they do that? Any guesses? You can just blurt them out. How about the ambassadors?
If like Wi-Fi or other technology has gone down, probably.
Like yeah, that. Probably. So they would use the light to do that. They could blink signals all over the world. What else could they do? What's another way? What if you haven't got any light? What if it's Alaska daylight? You know how much daylight we got up here? You can't even use a flashlight at night till August again or September. What would you do then? Any guesses? Well, let's try this. You guys hear that okay?
But if what you was, can use a rock for sound, why can't you just yell?
You could. You could say things like, yeah, don't look for my keys to my house under that trailer over there. You can't be discreet. So Morse code was developed actually to be discreet. It was our own American alphabet, and they use it during wartime. So here's the next part of this. Before there were cell phones, there were telephones. And before there were telephones, there were what? Does anybody know?
Telegraphs,
exactly. Telegraphs. So here's something else about sound. I'm gonna let Frank in. If you're out there on a submarine and you're transmitting these signals, how far away can you hear those, do you suppose, compared to the air? Anybody give me an idea? And maybe you learned this all in school, but the density of water is 800 times that of the air that we have above ground here. So 8 times denser means it's going to carry a long ways, and then the speed of sound moves 4 times faster in water than it does on land. So this is something to try if you guys get your lakes warmed up and you want to go swimming. Go underwater and have somebody go underwater a long ways away from you and pick up 2 rocks while you're down there and bang them together. You'd be amazed how far you can hear those things. So in the war, the submarines were trying to, the U.S. submarines and all the Allies would have their set of signals, and the Germans and the Japanese had their set of signals. So the thing was, if you did too much Morse code and took too long, enemies could locate, you could get a directional on you and send a torpedo and shoot you. So the Germans actually made this Enigma machine. It's actually a cool movie about it. But Enigma was a shorthand for Morse code that only took 25 seconds to put out a big long message by making some shortcuts. So that's a little bit about sound. Why am I telling you all that today? Because it's about messaging. It's about messaging today. And I wanted to give you something to think about there. So, you know, it's exciting to be an adult supporter of this wonderful summit. Every week, I revisit my life at 15, and I promise myself to go on at least one youthful adventure. This week, I asked my teen self, what would it be like around the lake where I live if the internet and cell service suddenly disappeared? Take a look at this. Thank you. there you have it. So, little online game for you guys. Now we're back on screen. Do you remember these things from last week? And did you remember me telling you that we'd have a quiz about the counting the number of holds? Did anybody do that? Does anybody know? Maybe you know it off the top of your head. Take a guess. Chat me. Oh, I can't put that in there. Oh, 20, close. Yeah, 20, 20. Closer. There you go. 25. 25, 18. 29. Ooh, 29. 28. Sheila Hurst nailed it. We used to call him the 28-hole cracker. Very good. Very good. So, great. So, there's something else we do here every week. Does anybody know what that is? I'm feeling it.
Because when I leave for the night, I ain't coming back. I'm talking pedicure on our toes, toes. Trying on all our clothes, clothes. Boys blowing up our phones, phones. Dropped up and playing our favorite CDs. Pulling up to the parties. Trying to get a little bit tipsy. Don't stop, make it pop, DJ.
Well, I had to tap out on the woolen hoodie, especially with the dance segment like that. That's a little too much. So, okay. Well, thank you for that.
Fun. It is so awesome to be working with you, Teen Ambassadors. It's an awesome program. And for all of you out there, your attendance this year makes you eligible to apply and become a Teen Ambassador next year. We'll have more details about how to join in the two remaining episodes.
Well, right now I've got a little game for you, just like I did in the past few weeks. I want you to leave your screens and type in or unmute yourself and show an item or type in someone that makes you smile and always whenever you see them.
Babe. Babe?
I was going to say, run over here. Jump in and put your face in the screen with me. Run over here and put your face in the screen with me.
What are we doing?
Make whatever makes you smile. Oh. All right. Great. Well, thank you all for bringing some stuff to the screen. My wife happens to be home today. She took the day off. Usually she's at work. She's home, and you know, we have a ball together. We make these films together, and it's just fun. We're out in the woods with the cameras late at night and running into dead moose that we don't know if the grizzly drug it down there or not, but a lot of fun. So, okay. Take it away, Zoe.
Here's what's coming at you in this episode and beyond. Today, Justin and I are going to tell you about the harmful effects of vaping, and we've got some fun stuff lined up with Kenny Linden on messaging. The theme for next week's episode is to wear shirts and hats about your favorite sports team. That's right, next week's theme is sports teams, and we really want to see some of your videos. Just email them to us, and we can show them next week.
And guys, we've got a couple more adult presenters to be presenting to you guys in those two episodes.
It's fun here at the summit where we learn a lot about ourselves and also about tobacco, which makes us think that it's time to give out some prizes.
Get ready to hit your chat box, and if you're an adult out there in the audience, remember that this is a youth topic and only youth can win.
So here's a multiple choice question for you. Guess the percentage of Alaska youth who use vaping devices in 2019. Is it A, 8%, B, 19%, C, 26%, or D, 37%?
Let's see. Seeing some correct answers there, girls?
There's one person who got the correct answer.
Who got the correct answer?
Zoe.
Let him keep guessing then. We got some other folks in there. Leo, keep guessing, man. You can hit it. Leo's going A. It's not A, I can tell you that. Layla, have you weighed in yet? What was yours? I gotta look. How about Hallie? Did you put it down?
I put D.
D? Okay. Well, girls, what is it?
It's C.
It's C. 26%. It's 26%. That's quite a bit.
So I have another question for you guys and guessing what percentage it was 3 years ago in 2017. Or 2017, I guess. Mm-hmm. You have to guess a number.
Yeah, it's a number. Mm-hmm.
For you guys. It's in the teens. I'll give you that hint.
There you go. 19, Justin's saying. 19% is a little high. 17 says Hallie, pretty close. 13 from Layla, it's a little bit low. Close. 16, Hallie, you got it, man. You win a prize. 16, very good.
Job. Very proud of you.
So, you think about that. So they did the last, this is comes from what they call the youth-based risk, it's YRBS, you've heard that term probably in schools. And they looked at 2017 statistics, showed that 16% of the youth did some kind of vaping in the past 30 days. They just released the 2019 ones last week, and that number rose to 26%. So a 10% gain in 2 years using vape stuff. So remember these past episodes, how we've been talking about the stuff that makes us strong? Now it's time again to hear about from our teen ambassadors about some of the stuff that can hold you down. So I'm going to turn it over to Justin and Zoe, and Eric, our engineer, is going to run the screen for them for their presentation today.
All right, guys, it is presentation time. I want to talk a little bit about e-cigarettes and exactly what happened. Like, where did we get to a situation where we had Juuls being in the bathroom, where we got to things like that? And right now, I do want to start up a really quick quiz, right? We've got a quiz here, and it says, some e-cigarettes are safe for youth. What do you guys think? I got a true or I got a false? All right, I got a false. Okay. All right, that is the correct answer. Nice job, Hallie. All right, let's move on to the next slide. So here's the four things we're going to be talking today. Today I want to talk about basically the rise of e-cigarettes and what exactly they are. Like, what constitutes an e-cigarette, or is that like an electronic? Is that a vaping device? What are we talking about, right? I'm going to start there. Then I'm going to start talking about, you know, the health risks. Like, why are we even talking about this? Is it risky to me? Is there, like, can I do it? And then what really leads to that use? Like, why are people doing it? And what you and what I can do about it. All right, now what you guys see on screen is actually the types of e-cigarettes on here. What you'll see on there is there's the tanks and mods, the rechargeable, and the disposable e-cigarette. So back in the olden days, way before Juul, way before anyone, right, we had these called the disposable e-cigarettes, right? What those were, they were called cigalikes. They look very similar to a cigarette and were basically just like the next extension, the next thing that went on with e-cigarettes. Then we got to tanks where people wanted these huge or big batteries, huge things, so they wanted this awesome amount, this huge, large amount of vape juice and of batteries to last forever. But then Juul and a lot of other companies came along and they did something strange that hooked youth, and it hooked them very, very badly. What they did is they changed this idea from it being a cigarette, from it being this definable tobacco product that looks gross and that no youth would ever want to use, and they turned it into something like technology, like a phone, right? If you can look at the Juul here, it doesn't look like any cigarette. It goes past the stuff where there's this juice and all these things, and it makes it look modern. And that's what really appealed to youth, was this modern look and this hideable look, this way that where you can just hide it, and it looks just fine. And it was also hard for teachers to see. And what happened is they started to come in to many different flavors. But also, when we're looking at these, what I was talking about, there's different shapes these things come in, right? You guys have seen them as e-cigs, vapes, and then Juuls, the most popular. They all come in different shapes. And still, regardless, there's still an e-cigarette. Slide. All right. So let's also do another quiz. And Zoe, can you help me out with this one?
Cigarettes. Oh, yeah. Yeah. All right. So true or false, most e-cigarettes contain nicotine. All right, we got some coming in. All right, let's see what the answer is. It is true. Most e-cigarettes contain nicotine, which is an addictive drug, regular cigarettes, and other tobacco products. According to the CDC, 99% of e-cigarettes contain nicotine, and this is especially as important for you to understand because nicotine can harm your brain, which can be developed until you are 25 years old. We'll talk more about that now.
All right, and
so
Zoe,
next we're going to talk about is e-cigarettes, and they contain nicotine.
Yeah, and Zoe, one thing I want to add really quickly is the reason we asked that question is back in a survey when they were taking a long time ago, they actually asked kids to say, hey, do you think that this thing that you're doing right now, nicotine? And the strange thing about it was that actually a sizable amount of people, like not just a tiny bit, a large amount of people actually thought they didn't contain nicotine, which was really strange.
Mm-hmm. So we told you what nicotine is, but did you know there are different types of nicotine? Some of you may have taken chemistry already, or you might be taking it in a few years. So you know about the pH scale, which measures what chemicals are in liquids and what is in swimming pool or hot tub. So why are we showing you this? Well, pH matters when it comes to how harsh nicotine is on your body, particularly your throat and when you're inhaling it. Most nicotine in cigarettes and e-cigarettes is what we call free-base nicotine, which means it's blue on the pH scale. The more blue on the pH scale, the more volatile or crazy it's going to be, which means that it'll be harsher on your throat. But get this, manufacturers of Juul have found a way around the harshness factor. They added a chemical to nicotine, which causes it to be more on the red pH scale by making it more red. It then becomes what we call nicotine salt rather than free base nicotine. Nicotine salts are less harsh on your throat. This is particularly concerned for young people because it allows nicotine to be used more easily, which increases likelihood of trying an e-cigarette and getting hooked.
Right. Zoe, that's really an important thing because back when cigarettes were popular, the things
all
that people
Juul,
started...
All Juul e-cigarettes have a high level of nicotine. Among the highest
Like I was saying, that with these things, right, with these cigarettes, the first one they started on was actually menthol cigarettes, right? They started up on those, and the reason why is because they were actually nicer on the throat. And what this ended up doing was it actually ended up having people start smoking and start getting other things because they were easier. And we see this exact same thing happening with Juul and with these ones when they're trying to make that things less acidic and trying to put that thing so it's nicer on the throat. Go ahead, Zoe.
Yeah, and all Juul e-cigarettes have a high level of nicotine, among the highest of e-cigarettes on the market. Juul nicotine liquid refills are called pods. A single Juul pod contains at least as much nicotine as a pack of 20 regular cigarettes. Some other brands have even more nicotine.
All right, guys, so we have another quiz going on here. Now, this is another one of those things from a survey, right? So this
and
is a thing.
We have another question.
Yeah, go ahead, Zoe.
Oh, no, you can continue. I'm sorry.
Yeah, sorry, guys. We're having a little bit of network issues right here. So those things are coming across. They're going from all the way over in the other side of Alaska, and they're trying to get over to our computer, and it's just making things a little bit more difficult.
Yeah.
So let's start with the quiz. We've got this quiz here. Survey says nicotine harms brain development. What do you guys think? Do you think it's true? Or do you think it's false? All right, I'm seeing one true. Okay. Okay. And I think that is the answer. For all of you guys who said true, give yourselves a pat on the back because you have gotten it correct. All right, Zoe, take it away.
Right now, important growth is happening in each of your brains, and it will continue to happen until you are about 25 years old. The brain is the last organ in the human body to fully develop. Exposing your brain to nicotine while it's in its important development phase can cause addiction and harm your brain. Why? Think about it like this. Each time a new memory is created or a new skill is learned, stronger connections or synapses are built between the brain cells. Nicotine changes the way these connections or synapses are formed, which can harm parts of your brain that can control attention and learning. Although adults may use nicotine products to quit, for youth, any exposure to nicotine is unsafe.
All right, guys, and let's talk a little bit about addiction, right? Because addiction is a form of learning, at least that's how it's processed in your brain, right? Then what happens is that the more nicotine in e-cigarettes, the harder they are, right? So this can produce an addiction so hard with that nicotine because it's so concentrated in those pods that it can be really, really addicted. Even the CDC says it's as addictive as cocaine sometimes. And also, there's an ad. I'm not sure where it is, but it should be on the screen. It's not. I don't know. It's not like you can just go out and buy a new brain, right? Right there. Oh, there it is. Boom. I see it, right? You can't just buy a new brain. You can't just get unaddicted. This is going to take a lot of things. So when Juul and when all these ones are marketing so extensively to youth, all that stuff, that causes this entire situation where there's this dependence. And Zoe, can you talk a little bit about the behavioral risks of vaping?
Another risk in using e-cigarettes is that many youth use them are more likely to go on to smoking cigarettes, even if they think they never will. Use of two or more tobacco products is common among middle and high school youth. Many young people who use e-cigarettes also smoke cigarettes. So the best thing to do is to protect your health is not to use any tobacco product at all, no matter how it's delivered. Whether it be an e-cigarette or a cigarette, nicotine is harmful to your health in general.
Hey guys, I can feel you in your seats. You guys are like, oh man, this presentation, it's taken so long. So let's get another knowledge check. Let's get this going. We got a question here. E-cigarette creates a harmless water vapor. Now, again, this is one of those things. It might seem strange. It might seem like it's common sense. But in the survey, they answered one of these maybe incorrectly. All right, I got a false. Anything else? Okay, I am getting that the correct answer was false. So nice to all of you guys who answered that. And I do want to explain that really, really quickly. So when we're talking about e-cigarettes, right, and we're seeing this, that term vapor, it's really not a strange thing, right? When we think about vapor, we've got this like boiling water and like that vapor that comes up, right? And we think that's what it is. But when we're talking about e-cigarettes, that's not really what it is at all. It's actually this thing called an aerosol. it's really harmful to your body. And even in e-cigarettes, we have all these strange things and really nasty things that actually cause damage to both your throat, your lungs, all that stuff, right? We've got these volatile organic compounds. We've got the nicotine we talked about. We've got these ultra fine particles. There's even stuff that causes cancer, Emma, and this heavy metals. Again, the reason why a lot of jobs are mandated and suggested the way they are is because of those heavy metal poisonings that can happen, right? And that stuff's in those e-cigarettes. And there's also flavorings that they might sound good, like cotton candy, but really they can actually lead to a serious lung disease.
You may have already seen this video, but let's watch it in case you haven't. If you'd like to more information about the things that are said in this video, you can go to a website, what.com.
There's an epidemic spreading. Scientists say it can change your brain. It can release dangerous chemicals like formaldehyde into your bloodstream. It can expose your lungs to acrolein, which can cause irreversible damage. It's not a parasite, not a virus, not an infection. It's vaping.
All right, thank you, Eric, for pulling up that video for us. And man, that video, I'm just gonna say that was scary, right? But what's even worse is that people have actually been poisoned by it. Hey, Zoe, can you tell us a little bit about that poisoning?
If poisoning wasn't enough, defective e-cigarette batteries have caused fires, explosions, and some of the worst results in serious injuries. Most explosives happened when an e-cigarette batteries were being charged. Here are some real life examples. Don't assume that an e-cigarette device is safe.
All right, guys. And again, if you guys remember what happened though with some of that stuff, right? When a cell phone exploded, it was taken off the market. Everything was bad with it. It was super out of the way. But a lot of the stuff that happened when this happened, it took months. It took a lot of time for this stuff even just to start arising with those actual things when they exploded. It took a while. And now that people are getting more aware, they're starting to, you know, lessen the use on those very at-risk products. There's also been a surge in e-cigarette use. I mean, it used to be, if you can see here, from 2017 to 2018. Now, these were 2 year ago numbers, right? We even see that surge when Charlie talked about it today. But it went from 11.7% to 20.8%, right? These numbers are super, super larger than they used to be. And one reason that is because of advertising. Zoe, why exactly is this advertising hitting people and how are they doing it?
Youth exposure to e-cigarettes advertising is increasing, and one of the main reasons for advertising, and these messages come in many different forms, whether it's in a store, signs, television ads, movies, the internet, social media ads, magazines. With cool magazines or newspapers, it's all around you. E-cigarette ads really reach nearly 4 in 5 middle and high school students, and youth exposure to these ads has increased in recent years.
And that's really a statistic to think about, guys, right? Remember that e-cigarettes, they're supposed to be marketed as the cessation tool, right? But as we're seeing, not only is the rise going on with youth smoking, with youth vaping and smoking going on, while the smoking is going on, the vaping is rising. But these ads that are only supposed to be going to adults, that are only supposed to be going to people that can legally buy these products, are actually reaching youth, which is pretty alarming and pretty scary. And Zoe, you have a quiz for us.
Yes, we have another quiz. Let's do another knowledge check. True or false? The tobacco industry is in the e-cigarette game. We got true. Well, the answer is true. Big tobacco companies are moving it to e-cigarettes to addict a new generation of users, including youth.
All right, and the weird thing about this, right, a lot of people claim to think, well, Marlboro, Camel, Kool, all those guys, they're nothing to do with this e-cigarette thing. It's not in their best interest. I mean, they're a different tool, right? They're getting them off of cigarettes. Why would they be promoting these? Well, the problem is they are behind it, right? For example, I mean, Kool, it sells Blu, right? We've got Marlboro that sells Mark 10, and Camel that sells Vuse. This might not be a way to get off it, but the newest iteration, and they're starting to invest in these products that are making it more easy to addict people. And it's not this pure thing where they're just coming up with new companies. They're actually being sourced by these huge tobacco giants. So they've got it very much in this game. All right, Zoe, can you help us with this slide?
Well, in addition to advertising, we also know that the flavors influence use. For example, many e-cigarettes contain fruit, candy, alcohol, or other flavors that youth find attractive and interesting. Most of your peers who use e-cigarettes are doing so because of the appeal to flavors, and are very few of them don't use flavors.
Yeah, and one flavor I want to mention real quick is mint flavor. Now, a lot of legislation has been trying to eliminate flavors. What they do is they eliminate a lot of the fruity flavors, but they leave mint. The one problem with mint is that it's actually quite a popular flavor, and it actually is nicer and easier than a lot of the other ones, and it's still quite attractive to youth, right? If someone has a vaping device and they instead call it a mint stick, right, instead of a tobacco stick, there's a huge difference between whether someone's going to take it or if they're going to leave it, right? So when this happens with that mint, it's still a flavor, and that's something we still need to fight against if you're going into the advocacy. All right, and as we went through, we've talked about what are e-cigarettes, we've talked about the health risks, we've talked about what leads to this e-cigarette use, all these factors, all these things, right? And now let's go on to our fourth one, what you and what I can do about this, right? There's a lot of ways to start quitting. Well, let's learn a little bit about this from Zoe.
If you haven't started using tobacco, don't start. Most teens don't use e-cigarettes or other tobacco products. If you use e-cigarettes or other tobacco products, the sooner you quit, the better. Here are some helpful resources to help you quit. There's the This Is Quitting app from Truce Initiative, Quit Start app, or Smoke Free Text for Teens from Smoke Free. For adults you trust about wanting to quit. It's normal for people to slip up when they're trying to quit. If you slip up, don't think of it as a failure. It means you might want to try quitting in a different way. Being prepared increases your chances of quitting successfully. Make a plan, stick to it, and keep trying to quit until you get it down.
Yeah, and guys, the reason we're telling you all about this is because at our school and a lot of places, we have these things where trying to find these resources for kids that people knew was actually quite tough, right? They knew that these additional resources, they knew that they existed, right? But where do they exist, right? Who's putting them off? If you guys need to know numbers, it's Truth Initiative is a great place that they have an actual quitting line. I had a slide up here, but it ended up getting mixed around. But Truth Initiative is a good one. And again, that app we talked about, there's all these resources. It's just to go and look for them and to help your friends out. One other thing that we want to talk about is secondhand exposure to vaping. Now, this seems like a strange thing, right? It's vapor, right? It's this aerosol. How is that secondhand smoke going to affect me? Well, actually, it's bad for you. Just like cigarettes, it's got these hard metals, these heavy metals, things that are not good for you to inhale. So if you guys see someone vaping, don't go by there and say and move around. Just kind of avoid the situation. Get out of there because that stuff can really, really hurt your lungs.
When it comes to your school, help your school get tobacco free. If it's not already, check with your school administrations to ensure school is completely tobacco free, including being free of e-cigarettes even after hours.
Right. And guys, if it's a huge problem at your school, if there's people vaping in the bathroom, you can get involved, right? You can talk with your peers. You can talk to people you know. You can talk to community leaders, and you can talk about ways to educate your peers in your school, right? You can actually go to part of our organization is what we do at Yeah, and what we do at Teens Against Tobacco Use is we actually go into classrooms and we can actually help people understand what exactly is going on with vapes. Also, I'm an ambassador for the campaign for tobacco-free kids. And what we did is we actually went on the national level and tried to get rid of flavors from the vaping ones. And there's actually going to be a new law that's going to help out with some of that.
All right, and then let's recap of what we learned today. E-cigarettes are a tobacco product that produce an aerosol by heating a liquid that typically contains nicotine flavorings and other chemicals. They can come in many shapes and sizes.
And those risks, right? What am I risking by doing this, right? That's going to be your brain developing, right? That's going to make it worse. That's going to make things not happen as they should. Addiction's going to happen, right? You're going to be addicted to this thing that you just tried. Right. And there's going to be behavioral risks. Right. Things like that can happen. And these things in that aerosol, those hard, heavy liquids, all that stuff is going to get into your lungs.
And then advertising and flavors make young people use cigarettes. Like all those flashy signs that you see everywhere that try to lure you in to make you appeal to the youth.
All right, guys, the best way to avoid this stuff, to get out of it, to make sure your friends are there is to live tobacco free, right? Get yourself to be the example and say, I don't use that tobacco. I don't do it. And I won't go into this e-cigarettes and I'll know how to refuse them, right? The most important takeaway is that the use of e-cigarettes, the use of Juul, all that stuff, no matter what they're telling you it is, like it's a mint thing, whatever it is, as long as it's that vape, that is what is going to be bad and unhealthy for you. So thank you guys all for that. And I'm going to turn it over to Charlie.
All right. Thank you. I just said, yeah, and Morse code. That's a big yeah. Thank you so much for that presentation. A lot of work went into it. A lot of good information there for everybody. And I'm sure you can get this after the summit too. We'll make this information available. So I'm inspired by Frank. You know, Frank was on and he kind of got me to start rapping a little bit, you know, and I kind of do a little bit around the house and stuff. So I like to introduce some of our guest speakers that way. So let me now introduce our next guest. She's a hometown whiz and an information biz. Facebook, Insta, Snapchat, a blendin', knows when the truth be a bendin', the telling is never ending. Here's Kenny Linden.
Woohoo! That was wonderful, Charlie. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So, hello, I was here last week. Like Charlie said, I'm Kenny Linden and I'm with Northwest Strategies. And we partner with the Tobacco Prevention and Control Program to do advertising. So thank you for that awesome presentation, Justin and Zoe, because what I want to talk about is messaging and how we craft messaging and for the platforms that we use. So specifically, we've talked a little bit about this last week, and then for those that have joined the youth advisory group over the past few months, we are in the process of really trying to create creative content that could be put on the radio or on TV or on Facebook or Instagram or as digital ads that is specific and targeted to youth. And part of what we've been trying to do is really bring in youth voices to create that messaging and that content, because it doesn't make sense for me at 32 to be telling teens how to have conversations around e-cigarettes if it's not my direct experience. So we want to hear from you all. So keeping that in mind as we talk about messaging, I want to give you an analogy of how we think about messaging. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. And so hopefully you all can see this quarantine birthday card. So if you want to think about messaging as a birthday card, so you're creating, maybe you bought it, maybe you're making it at home for your parents if you're a little kid. maybe you're putting together a birthday card for a grandparent or a friend or a significant other. When we're creating messaging, we're looking at all the things that go into a birthday card. So we're looking at how it looks, how it, who it's going to, what is inside the content. So if you were to send a happy quarantine birthday card to someone who doesn't have toilet paper and doesn't have hand sanitizer, you'd probably miss the mark for messaging on this one. So you really want to think about who the audience is. When we're using platforms like Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube, those are the places, Spotify is another one. Those are the places that we really go to when we are trying to talk directly to youth. Because part of what we found is, especially with Facebook, sometimes when we're boosting posts, they get shopped over to Instagram. So we know that more teens are on Instagram than they are on Facebook. So it depends on what platforms we're using. So when you're creating a birthday card, you want to think about those sorts of things. Are you going to be hand delivering it to someone? Are you going to be mailing it to someone? Are you going to be putting it in this super cool, awesome envelope that is decorated with puffy paint and sparkles and glitter and makes noises when you open it up? Or is it going to be a digital birthday card? Do you have family that live far away and you're going to email it to them? So you want to think about the packaging of how you are going to put your messaging into this packaging. And then you want to think about the content. So you want to think about the audience. Like I had said, are you sending it to a grandparent, significant other, best friend? It's going to determine what you put inside. So you're probably not going to say the same thing to your best friend as you would to your grandmother, unless your grandmother's your best friend, which is quite possible. So you want to think about those audiences. You want to think about the groups that you're trying to talk to. So when we're thinking about tobacco prevention messaging, we want to think about the youth that we are trying to talk to. Are we trying to talk to youth that are currently using tobacco products? Or are we trying to talk to youth who are at risk of using them? Or are we trying to talk to youth who have never used them before? So it all of those different decisions are going to affect how we create messaging, how we put it together, and how we package it. And then you also want to think about who is speaking. So you want to think about your relationship to who you're going to be delivering this birthday card to. And a big part of what we do with Northwest Strategies is we have, for our youth program, we have the Not Buying It Facebook page. And so we're trying to create an environment and a space that is teen directed, and it's different than, say, the Alaska Human Health and Human Services Facebook page is going to have a different sort of tone, where we try to use a lot of humor on that page. And so when you think about your relationship to the audience that you're trying to speak to, you want to think about things like, how much humor are you going to use? Does it make sense? Are you a very trusted source in public health? You're going to use a different sort of speech, and a different sort of crafted message than if you were sharing from a peer-to-peer, like you do here with the Yas Summit, which is really awesome. So think about those things as we craft messaging. Our messaging, it all comes from CDC best practices on tobacco prevention and control messaging. And so even if we're trying to package it in a way that is maybe humorous, it's still going to have evidence based and information, and so trusted information. So keeping that in mind. And then I want to show you our Not Buying It Facebook page. And one of our recent posts that's been really super popular. So you get an idea for what sort of content we create and how we get it out to the audience that we're trying to speak to. So this is one on our Not Buying It Facebook page. And this is one that we created based on feedback from you all during our youth advisory group about a post, because everybody loves cute pets and everybody really loves the grumpy angry cat meme. So we tried to make it Alaska specific and created it. We had our artists draw an Alaska husky or Malamute instead, which is great. And as you can see, because you're on my Facebook account, you can see some of the background information. So down here, you can see that it's reached almost 12,000 people on Facebook. So this is a post that we boosted, which means that we're trying to elevate our reach by putting money towards advertising. So like the presentation you just heard from, the tobacco industry is putting so much money towards advertising and towards targeting youth specifically, like we'd heard with flavors and things. And so we're trying to counteract that by creating messaging that comes directly from youth and is able to speak directly to youth. So that is also a plug to encourage all of you, if you have ideas, please send them to us. We want to elevate your voices and we want to get them out on our Not Buying a Facebook page if you're interested. We also create videos and things for YouTube, and we are in the process of trying to get an Instagram page too. So these are platforms you can use and we want to encourage you to do it. And so you got to think about the way you craft these messages. So you, on Facebook specifically, you have an image. So in this one, you have the dog with the logo, Not Buying It, and then also Nope, which is just a really clear, clean image with pretty small amount of text. And then you have to think about what you're going to actually put in the comment. So up here at the top is the copy that goes with the image. So you have to think on it on a few different levels of how you're going to present it. The image wise, so think about the outside of your birthday card for the image, and then the comment copy is going to be what you put on the inside of your birthday card. So thinking about those sorts of things. And then I also want to share a quick, fun example of really effective messaging that is surprising, because sometimes we get stuck in a rut of trying to say the same thing over and over again in pretty similar ways, and it can get really boring really quickly, which is unfortunate. But I want to show you a couple of different examples of ways that we can turn that messaging and that advertising on its head. So first, before I get to the really fun one, I want to show you something that we created recently based on the presentation that you all just had about what's in the cloud and flavoring. So this is one specifically about artificial flavoring. So taking the advertising that the tobacco industry is doing specifically to youth and changing it on its head to really target parents to let them know that this is happening. So you can see this one, kind of the Brady Bunch sort of boxes with different flavors and colors to really try to talk about what these flavors are doing and how they're targeting our youth specifically. All right, and then, so this is a really fun one. This showed up a few months ago. And back to the conversation last week about trusted sources. So knowing what pages you're on and where these things are coming from. This is not the actual National Park and Forest Service page. This is the alternative page. So don't think of this as a governmental page. This is alternative. And so they show a lot of funny things as well. So this is one that showed up back in March from an artist called Amber Shares, and she put together this entire advertising campaign about national parks from terrible Yelp reviews that people had shared about each one of these parks. So you have all of these quotes from people saying terrible things about these amazing places, and it was incredibly surprising and incredibly, it went viral really quickly. So this was a really fun one talking about Joshua Tree National Park. The only thing to do here is walk around the desert. This one reminds me of being here in Alaska. There are bugs and they will bite you on your face. This is another one from Death Valley National Park. Ugliest place I've ever seen. And so you can use a lot of humor is really effective. And I think especially when we're talking to teens that can be a way that you can kind of break through the noise and have a conversation. This is one from Yosemite. Trees block view and there are too many gray rocks, which some people would say is kind of the point. Another one, okay if you like cactus. So, and there's a few of them here. Looks nothing like the license plate. A hole, a very, very large hole talking about the Grand Canyon. All I saw was a lake, mountains, and some trees. Save yourself some money, boil some water at home. Talk about Yellowstone again with the geysers. Scenery is distant and impersonal. And so these are really great ways of getting people to pay attention, because you would not think about national parks and by terrible Yelp reviews, but there have been a lot of parks that have really capitalized on this, which is really exciting, and have gotten a lot of great advertising leverage. So those are all of those. And yeah, if you have any questions, please always reach out. We've got great resources on creating messaging and trying to get it out there and really trying to work with all of you as well. So yeah, thank you all. Do you have any questions about platforms or different ways of creating messaging or getting it out there? You're welcome to ask. Or I'd love to hear, so this could be a prize if you still have prizes. I'd love to hear your favorite advertising campaign or your favorite commercial or something that really resonated with you, something that you remember and kind of stuck with in your head. And it doesn't necessarily have to be tobacco related. It could be anything. You could shout it out or you could put it in the chat box. Cereal. I want to hear more about cereal, Ayla. Was it a type of cereal? Like a rock Chevy from the 90s. Yep. Those State Farm music Spotify ads. Yeah, they're very, all of those music ads are super catchy. Geico, the baby says Geico for the first time and the moms flip when they hear it. Yep, that's a good one. These are great. Yeah, so there's something about each one of these that sticks with you. And a lot of times it's the unexpected. So when you're thinking about trying to create a messaging campaign to really talk to other youth, think about ways that you can have a really surprising conversation. And thank you, Charlie. Yeah, Farmers Insurance.
Thank you, Kenny, for having that on, because it so happens that next week's episode involves all of the participants. And we're going to talk about making some messages together and stuff we want to say. And so we'll kind of explore our creative sides. And we're going to bring Frank back too. And he's got a storytelling segment coming up. So I'm really excited about next week, because we're kind of leading up to the end of the culmination of the series. And we hope that we started out empowering youth. We took them through some of the other things that can deter from that empowerment. And now we're going to roar. We're going to take our voices and build something that sticks. And so beautiful. Well, thank you so much again for joining us, Kenny. Crazy stuff. That was a great lesson.
Thank you all.
And guys, remember, when we're doing these like messaging, all this advertising, all that kind of stuff together, all that can be applied throughout, like when you're making your PowerPoints, when you're making all that stuff can come together and you can make some really cool things. And we're going to practice that all next week.
Thank you, Justin.
Thank you all for coming, and hopefully we'll see you next week and learn something new again. And thank you, Kenny, for providing great information for youth and the adults that are on this call. Hope you guys have my balls.
It goes electric, baby, when I turn it on. All through my city, all through my home. We're flying up, no ceiling when we in our zone. I got that sunshine in my pocket. Got